please continue to give us your prayers. And we'll be praying for your family too. I just got one more thing I want to leave with you. If you're going for something, thank you.
Tuesday time. Come on in. Where y'all at? Hey, Brenda. How are you? Good to see you here. Yes. Get to share.
Some of y'all have been into some bad relationships.
Yes. Thank you, my cousin. Thank you.
You know that there is a love named Jesus, and he will supply your every need.
Hey, Kiki. What you doing in H-Town? Everyone, let me go to God in prayer. Father, this afternoon, Lord God, we come to you just as we are. Lord, I, your daughter, come to you. I had a struggle. I had to push to come. I almost didn't even come on, Lord God, but you gave me the strength that I needed, Father. And so today, I just say thank you. Lord, I didn't want to come on. I didn't want to talk. I didn't want to even talk about you. I didn't even want to get up, Lord God. But I thank you that you gave me perseverance, strength to push forth and to continue to move on. Father, sometimes following you and doing what you called me to do is a struggle. Sometimes it's hard to just stay steadfast and movable. And today was one of those days, Lord, but I pushed forth and I kept moving, kept calling on the name of Jesus, Lord God. And so here I am as your vessel, Lord. Allow the Holy Spirit to hover over me from the crown of my head to the sole of my feet. Sometimes, Lord, we have to come to you on our all behalf. And this is one of those days, Lord, I'm coming to you on my own behalf. Father, I ask that whoever hears this or hear the sound of my voice, listen to the replay, that they are still blessed by the Holy Spirit word that you've given me to share today, Father. God, I don't take this lightly. And I thank you for choosing me as your vessel. So it's in Jesus' name we pray as I move forward with the strength you're going to give me. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Yeah, so before we get to the Holy Spirit-led word and even to Testimony Tuesday, I'm going to be a little vulnerable right about now. I really did not feel like coming on doing Testimony Tuesday. I really did not even really wanted to get out of bed. I drug up out of bed. For the last 2 days, I've been inside. And so the Holy Spirit is saying, you need to get out and let the sun hit you. You need to get out. And I kept asking God, what is going on with me? Because, you know, the prayer advocate, I have some down moments and some down days too. You know, as a prayer advocate, I have times where I don't want to do what the Lord has called me to do. I'm just being honest. I have times when I just don't want to do nothing. I just don't even want to get out of bed. And I've found that I've experienced that a lot of times. It's since I've had COVID. I used to didn't have those extremely fatigued days and days where I just lay there, flip the TV, you know, go back and forth. My eating is poor on those days. And so I've been praying and asking God to give me something different that I can do on those fatigue days. I don't know what it is. And I've heard a lot of COVID-19 people who really had a serious encounter with COVID-19. They are experiencing that fatigue thing too. I don't know what it is. And in speaking with my doctor, there's no cure that they've come up with that give you suggestions on things that you can do to try to relieve it. But for me, these past 2 days, it was just in the bed. I haven't even been outside to know what the weather looked like. I peeped out the blind, kind of looked out and saw the sun shining. But this morning when I woke up, I was like, Lord, I've got to shake this. I've got to, you know, I've got to get out of this funk mood. You know, as women, you know, our hormones and our emotions and all that start acting up sometime. I'm sure all of you all can relate to what I'm saying. And I'm sharing this because it was a struggle for me to come today and do Testimony Tuesday. But God, he came with that Holy Spirit and lifted me up and said, I'll give you what you ask for when you're doing the will of what I've called you to do. And so here I am. And I am asking you, send a prayer up for the prayer advocate. Yeah, send a prayer up for me in your prayer time and ask God to just continue to keep me and cover me, give me the strength that I need to move forward. Whatever God leads you to pray, send a prayer up for me. I would appreciate it. I'm just like, hey, Sharon, I'm just like, I don't know. I can't even hardly put words, but I do notice that sometimes fatigue kicks in so strong, all I can do is just lay down. I have the mindset of wanting to do more, and I have the mindset of wanting to do other things, but my body says, no, not today. No, not today. So I pushed myself out of bed, hadn't even really had quiet time with God because I was trying to mentally get ready for Testimony Tuesday. Thank God that I already prepared and allow God to give me what to talk about today. But I was just like, Lord, I don't know. I don't know what it is. But anyway, I'm not going to let it defeat me. I just want to share that with you all today so you can know the prayer advocate is human. And I do have those times and those moments where it's like a hole I'm in and I'm just trying to pull up and come up out of it. That fatigue gets me so tired. Until even when I try to push to do something and make it different, it's like, no, you're just going to lay there. And so for the last 2 days, I've been kind of laying in bed trying to do what God has called me to do along with doing other things. I thank God for retirement because I don't know how I would be able to do a 9-to-5 when this fatigue kick in. So God is good. He knows what's best for us at all times. So welcome. I am Anita J. Merchant. For those of you who don't know me, I went on a soapbox before I even introduced myself. But I wanted to share that with you all. God is good. I'm going to say that again. God is good. I am Anita J. Merchant, known as the Prayer Advocate. See, I don't even have my flow going. You know, I'm just like rambling and going on. But bear with me. And I am known as the prayer advocate. I am sold out to prayer. I am a certified prayer intercessor. And what I do is I help educate, equip, and encourage women who are struggling with their prayer life or who need to establish and maintain a consistent prayer life. You all know, we all know that prayer is the substance of your life. If it's not, you might want to rethink it and put prayer in the forefront. And so moving along, I have a couple of announcements. You know, we take care of those things before we do anything else. The first one is I'm asking you to go to my YouTube channel, hit subscribe, and give me a thumbs up on any one of the videos that you review. The videos are reviewed, are uploaded every Tuesday or Wednesday after Testimony Tuesday in case you need to listen to the replay. Everyone know, I hope by now, that I have a new book out. And the new book is named Trophy of Grace. This is a new book, Trophy of Grace. And I want to encourage you to purchase your copy if you haven't. You can purchase it from me or you can purchase it from Amazon. The book is $25 and it is going to bless you. Not only bless you, but everybody on this earth knows of somebody who's had an encounter with COVID-19. It may not be a close member of your family. It may be. It could be your neighbor. It could be someone at church you know. It could be someone down the street. It could be a family member or a friend or acquaintance who has had an encounter with COVID-19. Now, we all know, and people really get this confused. Everybody has had an encounter with COVID-19. And the reason why I say this is because if you was in the world 2019 and 2020, some of 2021, you had an encounter with COVID-19. You might not have had the virus to attack your body, but you had the shut-in time. You had the limited limitations on things that you could buy. You had the limitations on where you could go, how you could do it, when you can do it. So you had an encounter with COVID-19. When I say that, people think, oh, well, I didn't have the virus, so I didn't have an encounter. So let me help you and bless you today. That if you were breathing and still in the world during those times, you had an encounter. You was not excluded from encountering. You may have been excluded from the virus. So I want to encourage you to purchase a book, not only for yourself, but for someone else you know who's had an encounter with COVID-19. It would really bless them to know that they were not in it all alone, and that they would know that even walking through the shadow of the darkness of COVID, that God was still with them. So I want to encourage you, get the book. And this is to Alexandria, my hometown. My first stop for my book signing. I have about 5, 6, or 7 that has been put on the books for me to travel to sign books. But Alexandria, my hometown, you're my first stop. And I want to encourage you, if you have not RSVP, I'm coming to Alexandria, Louisiana on Saturday, May 21st. It will start at 4 p.m. where we're going to do a sip and a sign. I'm going to be talking about the book. I'm going to be interviewed by Attorney Ingrid Johnson, who's my niece, about the book. We're going to have a discussion. You don't want to miss it, because just reading the book, it's good and I appreciate you, but to hear me talk about and have a conversation about what's in the book is where you're really going to be blessed. So on Saturday, May 21st at 4 p.m., my first stop, my first book signing is in Alexandria, Louisiana. It's going to be held at the Hotel Bentley on 200 DeSoto Street. You need to pre-order your book in order to get into the discussion. You can't just walk up and show up on the day of the event and get into the discussion. You have to RSVP because it's limited space. God instructed me, and in speaking with the host, I want a small congregation. I don't want it just open to where people can walk in and walk out because of the intimacy of the conversation. And so if you plan on attending, space is limited. It's filling up. I ask that you go on and RSVP, saying that you're going to attend, and pre-order the book. Now, you won't be able to walk up to 200 DeSoto Street and say, I want to come to the book signing. You won't be able to enter. It's RSVP because we have limited space. So if you're coming, I would love to see you. I would love to take a photo with you, sign the book. But I would love for you to hear the discussion that's going to take place on Saturday, May 21st. So if you plan on coming, don't wait until the last minute. You know, as women, sometimes we wait till the last minute and say, I'll take care of it, I'll get to it, or thinking the day before that there's going to be a space, because it's probably not going to be a space. There's still some spaces left. If you want to attend, I encourage you to make sure you are a SVP. I am looking forward to it. I am excited about what God is going to do to speak through me to the people that are in the room about not only the book, but my experience in life with COVID-19. So you all order the book. If you're not going to come, I understand, but I would appreciate your support. Now let's go to a shout out. And I want to give a shout out today to a young lady who recently she received an extravagant prayer box. And her name is Jasmine Jones. I don't know, you may have seen the video that she posted about a prayer box that she received. She won the extravagant prayer box the time when I had the discussion with Brother Larry Moore. And so she got her prayer box and she made a video about it, and she's texted me and messaged me about how excited she was about getting it and about how excited she knows it's going to bless her prayer life. Now, here's a distinction. The extravagant prayer box is bigger and contains more items all pertaining to prayer. The regular prayer box is a smaller size, but it also has things that contain prayer, things to help you with your prayer life. And some of you on here probably have already received one, and I hope it's going to bless you, or it will bless you and enhance your prayer life. And so I want to give a shout out to Jasmine for taking the time to do a live video. I mean, it was really, really funny. It was cute. It was comical. But you could see in her face and her voice and the things that she talked about how blessed she was. And so I thank God for giving me this vision of the prayer box. This is something that he imparted in me while I was healing from COVID-19. And so I have a passion about it. I've had some people, companies, and others to contact me and say that I need to start charging for the prayer boxes. I need to make it a business. But I've been praying about it, and I'm going to wait and let God let me know if I need to do that. Because if he's saying no, then I need to be obedient to what he said. Because he's blessed me to be able to have the provisions to get the things that are included in the prayer boxes and the prayer boxes themselves. So let me stop rambling. And that's my shout out to Jasmine. Jasmine, I thank you for your video that you did, and I pray that the box really bless you. The song we was listening to, you see how I'm so thrown off? I didn't even tell y'all what the song, the opening praise song was, Blessing in the Storm, Kirk Franklin and the Family. I hope you all are getting to see how I am human too, even though I'm sold out to prayer and the prayer advocate. Today is just, it's just thrown off, I'm going to be honest. And so let me do the testimony part. I had a really good conversation with a former coworker. Had no idea. God, I'm telling you, God is amazing. He does things when you least expect it. Hey, Lo, what's going on? And so, hey, Anita Sanders, I got a text from this person. And they asked if I could call them, or if they could call me. And so I looked at the message, and I'm going to be honest with y'all. When people send me texts and saying, can you call me, or can I call you, or whatever, I don't just automatically respond yes and get on the phone with them. I take a little time and I say, God, am I supposed to answer this? Or how am I supposed to answer this? Or do you want me to answer this? See, that's why it's so important to be in tune with the Holy Spirit and just let the Holy Spirit lead you. Because sometimes we get ourselves in things that we weren't even supposed to be involved in, or that we weren't even supposed to do. So I didn't immediately react on it. Because I said, Lord, if it's an emergency, I already know you're going to handle that part. But I waited a couple of hours before I responded after praying about it. And doing other things, God nudged me and said, it's okay to call her. It's okay to have a conversation with her. Not knowing what it was going to be about. Bear with me. I'm going to get to the Holy Spirit led word. And so I called her. And she began to just cry. I mean, heavy cry. And she began to share with me some things that she was going through and what was going on in her life at the moment. And she said to me, she said, I immediately thought about you, Anita. And I immediately said I needed to call you. She said, remember how you used to allow us to come into your office and you would pray with us when we were having a bad day, or when we would come in and say the kids was acting up, or we would come in and say, I'm not doing good today and my work is behind. You know, whatever we would come in there with. You know how you would get up and close the door and the first thing you would say, well, let's pray before we have a conversation about maybe what you can do. And so I was like, yeah, I remember that. See, God allowed me to use prayer in my professional career for over 30 years with the government. Most people wouldn't say that. Most people would shun away on the job that they pray or that they even a Christian. Well, everyone knew on the job I wasn't shy about being a Christian, and I definitely wasn't shy about saying, yes, I pray. Yes, do you want me to pray for you? Do you need me to pray for you? I did it in a professional way, because you know there's always a way to introduce and bring God into some areas of your life, or bring God into situations and circumstances depending on the person and the place of where you are. And so she began to share with me what she was going on. Now, by profession, I am not a counselor. I'm not a therapist. I can't handle that part, and I don't have a problem telling people or recommending, wait a minute, this is a little bit too much for me. I think you need a therapist. I think you need to speak with someone in the profession. I don't have a problem telling people that, because God has told me, stay in your lane, Anita. And so that's what I do. But anyway, so I'm listening to her. I could feel the pain and hear it in her voice. And so as I listened, and I allowed her to get it out, and we talked. But she shared some things with me that she was dealing with and going on with her health, with family, with children, with spouse, and all of that. And so after listening to her, my first question was her, have you taken all of this to the Lord in prayer? Now, some people say, well, don't nobody want to be hearing about prayer all the time, Anita. That's your first response. And the reason why that's my first response is simply because I can't fix it. Only God can fix it. Now, I can help you go to him, give you some suggestions on how to go to him, or even some prayers to pray to him, but I can't fix it. See, I'm not walking around. I'm not the fixer, okay? I'm just the messenger, the person God is using to relay information to you on how you may be able to come to him. And so I began to share with her some words of God. I began to share with her some things that she might want to start doing. And then I asked her, I say, how often have you been getting into the word of God? I'm going to lose some people now. How often have you been getting into the word of God? And this is going to tie into what Holy Spirit led word is today, okay? And she said, well, I may get into the word maybe once or twice a week. And I said, well, we need to shift that first. You need to be getting into his presence every day, because every day the problem is getting worse and worse and worse. So she said, well, yeah, you're right. I said, you need to get on not only in his presence, you need to find a space in your home, and you need to be really getting down into his presence every day. I said, because it sounds like, come on, Holy Spirit, the adversary has taken shop in a chair, in a seat in your home. Yeah, just by listening to what she was saying, what's going on. I say, see, he done took a room, or he done took over the whole house. He done took residence in your home. And so that's why you got so much chaos in your home. That's why you got so much going on. You don't know which way to turn. I say, so you need to shift, and you need to find somewhere in your house, because you need to get him up out of there. And she was like, oh, I didn't think about that. I said, yeah, because the thing she was telling me, immediately the Holy Spirit was saying, yep, he there. Yep, he roaming boldly. Yep, he doing what he want to do. Yep, he's in there to steal and kill and destroy. Yep, he's in there. And as she was talking, and I said, yeah, I said, not only that, I said, you need to walk through your home. Come on, Holy Spirit. And you need to open up your mouth and speak the word of God to get that adversary up out of there. See, sometimes we miss the mark of knowing why it's so important to have quality time with God in your dwelling domain, in your home where you lay your head at. Because don't think that the adversary is just outside of the four walls of your house. Don't think that the adversary is just sitting somewhere not doing anything and he ain't busy. I'm here to tell you today, he is roaming boldly. He don't care if it's your house, your car. He doesn't care if it's your husband or your children. He don't even care if it's the job. He just roams boldly, because that's what he does. That's what he specializes in. But oh, we have a God, an amazing God, an awesome God, an all-powerful God, that when we use what he's given us to walk through our house and pray, to walk through our house and talk about, to walk and tell the devil, you got to get up out of here, to tell the devil, no matter what you're trying to do, you've got to go. You see, this morning I had to get up and start speaking over myself, because I was in just such a funk mood. I was just like, ugh. I was just like, and I had to remind myself, girl, you got power. Open up your mouth and speak what the God of our universe has given us authority to do. And so I began to tell her, girl, You need to get him up out of there. I said, he busy and he done took residence. And so she began to cry. She said, you know, I could feel that I hadn't been having my time with God. I hadn't been praying. See, we don't have time to be slacking in our prayer life. We don't have time to be slacking and keeping our relationship tight with God. We don't have time for that. Because I'm telling you, the adversary don't take vacations. He don't take a 15-minute break. He don't take days off, see? And we have to be reminded why God allowed us to have this tool of prayer and to be able to have an intimate relationship with him. It's because he knows what we're up against. And so I want to encourage you as my testimony today. And I shared with her some other things. As a matter of fact, me and her are going to be working one-on-one. And she said to me, she said, I knew I needed to call you. She said, and I just couldn't do it anymore. I couldn't take it anymore. And she said, I said, well, let me just call Anita. And so God, thank you for convicting me, Lord, today. God reminds us, all we have to do is be reminded to call on the name of Jesus, to go to him, to ask him to come into the presence of where we are, to open up our mouths and let the adversary know, no, you ain't running nothing here. You've got to go. You evicted up out of this home. You evicted up out of my car. You evicted up off my children. You evicted up off my husband. You evicted at the job. We just have to tell him he got to flee and go. And so I want to encourage you. You having some issues, struggling, some things going on with you, your home, your children, your husband, the job, your finances, whatever it may be. You need to sit down and get a little bit more closer into the word of God and let him speak to you and let him comfort you and let him hold you and love you up out of that situation. I want to encourage you to do that today. So the prayer box giveaway today is simply this. I want you, praise the Lord, I want you to type in the box on the screen right now one thing that you need God to help you with. You're going to have to be vulnerable and truthful. This ain't about me and ain't about nobody else who may read it. It's between you and God. What has God put on your heart that you are vulnerable about, that you need him to do something about it, that you need him to change it, that you need him to shift it? I want you to type it right now. God, I need you to, whatever it may be, I need you to strengthen my marriage. I need you to strengthen my relationship with you. God, I need you to help me with my children. God, I need you to help me reorganize my finances. Lord, I need you to bring unity between me and my husband. Whatever it may be, I want you to type it right now. Because what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back and I'm going to pray over what your request is. But I'm going to also let the Holy Spirit lead me into whoever will win the prayer box today. Type it. Don't be sitting back like you don't have nothing, because everybody got something. You see, I was vulnerable today. Gave my testimony. Told y'all how I was feeling, how I woke up, what was going on with me in the last 2 days. You see, you got to be vulnerable sometimes and let people know you need Jesus just like they do. So I want you to type, okay, Lord, it's my finances. Okay, all right, I got you. Anybody else want to type what it is I need God to do? What is it? I need God to fix. I need God to change. I need God's help. I need God's direction. What is it that you need God to do? It's got to be something that you need him to do. And those of you who listen to the replay, I want you to type too what you need God to fix or to change or to shift or to remove or to help with. I want you to type that in the chat down so I can see what it is that you are needing God to do. And I'm going to pray over those requests. So that's why I'm asking you to type what you need God to do. Type it. Don't have too much pride and feel like, oh, well, I'm not going to let nobody know, because it's between you and God. I'm just going to go to the throne of grace for you about what you are typing. Come on, I know there's more people who have something that you want God to fix. We're going to thank God for how he's touching each one of you to type what you need God to fix and to help with whatever it is you need help with. And so I'm going to go back and pray over those things. And then I'm going to also let the Holy Spirit lead me on to win the prayer box giveaway today. So moving along, let's get to the Holy Spirit-led word. Now, the reason why I named this what I named this today is because I've been getting a lot of texts about people having trials and tribulations, or they're feeling down, or things are going on in their lives. And so today's testimony Tuesday is called The Desert. Why? Simple as that. The desert. Why? We sometimes get caught up into what we're into going through and how life is going. And we tend to start questioning God. Why? God, I say my prayers. God, I go to church every Sunday. God, I attend Bible study. God, I pray. God, I do all these things. So why am I in the desert? You know, James 1 and 3, and I'm reading the NIV scripture. It says, you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. Sometimes the desert isn't a trial at all. It's simply a moment to be still and be loved by God. Now, that kind of sounds contradicting, don't it? Desert and be loved by God. I know that's kind of like, huh? Wait a minute, Anita. Wait, You're probably thinking, really, Anita? Trials and tribulations while you are in a desert could be where God is saying, I need you to be still for a little while. And I want to love on you. And in order to get you still and to love on you, I need to put you in the desert. I don't know about you, but I've been in the desert before several times, many times. And I'm sure you all can testify you've been in the desert. Put on there if you've been in the desert. If you've been in the desert, type in the chat, I have been in the desert. And I'm saying this because life takes you to the desert. There's no one who is excluded. You're going to read about this in my book when I talk about the suffering part of my encounter with COVID-19. How no one is excluded from suffering. I don't care if you're the highest priest, the Pope, done had some suffering moments. I don't care if you got doctor in front of your name. I don't care if you got a bank full of money. I don't care if you popular, all-star, movie star, whatever. We all have been in the desert. And so many times we ask God, why? So let me say this. There's some quotes that I often go and reflect to when I'm in the desert. And the trials and tribulation quotes is this. Trials teach us what we are. They dig up the soil and let us see what we are made of. That's written by Charles Spurgeon. Another thing is, prayer is the best armor against all trials. A gem cannot be polished without friction, nor a man perfected without trials. Being on a spiritual path does not prevent you from facing the darkness, but it teaches you how to use the darkness as a tool to grow. Those are just some general quotes on trials and tribulations that I refer back to a lot of times when you're either going into the desert, you're in the desert, or you're coming out the desert. It's one of those three things. You're either going into it, you're either in it, or you're coming out. We have to entertain, you know, when we're in the desert, the first thing we tend to do is what? We entertain the devil more during those times than any other time in our lives. When we're in the desert, we start entertaining the devil. Because we do that because when you're in the desert, your faith gets shaky. You go, ooh, wait a minute. You know, you get a little shaky there. It gets small. And the first thing we start doing is we ask is, what did I do wrong? What did I do wrong, God? Or we say, why has God allowed me to go through this? Or why am I having such hard times? We could go on and on and on and on with the whys when we're in the desert. Because first of all, we don't really understand. It doesn't necessarily mean that you've done something wrong or you've sinned to go into the desert. I want to talk to you about five ways or five reasons that we may sometimes be put in the beginning of the desert, smack in the middle of the desert, or coming out of the desert. We usually have some reasons. Sometimes we don't understand the reasons. Sometimes we don't either understand why God did it, and we begin to question him. Not that we question him in the fact of like we're questioning his authority, but we just want to understand why. We just want to know, well, what's going on? Why am I in this desert? It feels like I just came out of one, right? And so when you're in the desert, There's many, many, many reasons, but I'm going to share five of them with you. And here's number one. God is making you more humble. See, sometimes we can get a little too prideful, thinking we're doing it on our own and we're running our own on. We running everything. You know, we all big and bad. And sometimes he'll put you in the desert to humble you. I know we've all witnessed and experienced that in our lives where we thought, oh, well, I'm running this and I'm doing this and I'm going to do it this way. Not even consulting and thinking of the will of God. We just go do it our way. But we all know how that turns out. Another reason is not spending quality. Y'all get this one. Quiet time with the Lord. Now, I'm not talking about the regular routine thing, you know, where you say a few little words and you go on about your day and your busy schedule. See, sometimes we get so, so busy with our agenda, our schedule, our calendar, that we push God to the side. And we want God to work around our schedule when we should be working around his. And so sometimes when we're not spending that quality time, I'm not talking about just going to church every Sunday and on calling in on the prayer line. I made a post about that. Calling in on the prayer line. And there's nothing wrong with those things. I encourage them. But that quality, quiet time with God has nothing to do with those things. And when we get to the point to where we start neglecting the quality, quiet time, God will take you into a desert. It's no way around it. Remember, he's a jealous God. And when we read that scripture, he's a jealous God, it's nothing negative about that. I know I don't take it negative that he's a jealous God. I am humbly grateful that he get jealous if I don't spend enough time with him. That's just how much he loves us. And so when you don't spend enough quality time, that might be why you're in a desert. Another reason is God could be protecting you from something bigger, a bigger problem, a bigger place, a bigger whatever, and you can't foresee what it's going to do or happen. And so he may put you in the desert to spare you so that you won't go on that road or walk that path or go down that street or do whatever it is you willingly want to do. He may put you in a desert to protect you. Have you ever thought about that? How am I being in the desert and God protecting me? Because he's loving you while you're in the desert. He's keeping you from all hurt and harm. He's allowing you to just smurve in his presence so that you won't, when you come out of the desert, you won't go into where the problem may be or where you may be harmed or whatever he may be protecting you from. That's another reason why he will put you in the desert. Another reason is the trials that we're in, when he put us in the desert, what does it do for you? I don't know about you. It makes my faith even stronger. It builds our faith. See, when our faith gets to being wavery, you know, he says, have faith the size of a mustard seed. Sometimes we don't even have the mustard seed faith. You know, God will put you in a desert where you got to be reminded, I've got to have faith in him. I've got to call on him. I need him. So my faith has to be strong, unwavery, not falling from one side to the other. It has to be firm that I have the faith. And last but not least, he may put you in the desert for his glory, an opportunity for you to have a testimony. See, that's what happened to me with COVID-19. I was in the desert. I was suffering because God wanted to get the glory at the end. He wanted me to have a testimony. Not only did he want me to have a testimony, he instructed me write a book about it because I want the world to see my glory. And that's how the book came to the title, Trophy of Grace. Because when you read the book and see about my encounter with COVID-19, you're going to say, yeah, that was grace. And you will understand why the book is named Trophy of Grace. The book is named Trophy of Grace specifically because God needed to get the glory. But he used me and kept me to be able to talk about his grace. And so as I always say to myself, he used me as his trophy of grace. He put me on display. Not that I'm bragging and I'm thinking I'm better than any other child of God, but he used me and put me on display to show people that a prayer life is not just a surface level thing. A prayer life goes real deep. And when you read the book, you're going to understand two things. While I'm sold out to prayer and why I speak about it as passionate as I do. I want to encourage you when you're in the desert and you ask the why, start thinking and marveling on some reasons that he may have you in the desert. Don't ask him automatically, Lord, take me out the desert. I don't want to be in it. Because sometimes being in that desert could be a blessing in the long run that you would never thought that you could have received the glory of God. You know, I always like to leave with a scripture. And so I'm going to give you a scripture to meditate on when you go in the desert, when you're in the desert, and even when you're coming out the desert. And it is Psalm 71:14-17, the NIV. Again, that's Psalm 71:14-17, NIV. And this is what the word of God reads. As for me, I will always have hope. I will praise you more and more. My mouth will tell of your righteous deeds, of you saving acts all day long. Though I know not how to relate to them all, I will come and proclaim your mighty acts, sovereign Lord. I will proclaim your righteous deeds, yours alone. Again, that was Psalm 71:14-17. When you start going into the desert, or you're in one right now, you're coming up out of one, whichever one it may be, I encourage you to meditate on that scripture. It's going to shift your mindset. It's going to help your heart of understanding why you are in the desert, why you may be coming out of one, going into one, whatever way it may be. Wrong. We're going to pray about the desert, because someone who may hear the replay or someone who's listening to the live right now may be going into the desert, already in the desert, or coming out. And so we're going to pray and thank God for the desert. Father God, we thank you today. Oh, mighty God, our heavenly Father, our Lord of Lords, our King of Kings. Father, today we come to you and we just say thank you. We're thanking you for the desert. It may not sound good to most people, for thanking you for being in the desert, for thanking you for taking us in a desert, for thanking you for leaving us in the desert for a little while, for bringing us out of the desert. It may not sound good to the average person, Lord, but we say thank you today. We thank you because you love us so much that you want to protect us. You want to guide us. You want to love us. You want to show us, and you most of all want to continue to bless us. And so the desert is part of all those things when we come to you and ask you in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you that you pick us individually. You choose us individually on how we will go into the desert, how we're going to make it through the desert, and how we're going to be when we come out the desert. We just say thank you, Lord. A lot of people won't pray a thank you prayer for a desert, Lord, but today we're shifting our mindset and our heart, and we're coming to you saying thank you. We're not only coming to you to ask you and beg you for the good things, but we thank you that you love us so much that you choose to take us in a desert for whatever reason it may be. And we are different and better when we come out on the other end. So we thank you that you think enough of us and you love us enough, Lord God, to bring us to the desert. Lord, it's not a good feeling sometimes. We don't even understand why. But today and moving forward, we're going to continue to trust you. And we're going to have that faith like unshakable faith, that when that time comes for our desert, because we know it's coming, we know where no one is excluded, but we're going to thank you in it. We're going to praise and worship you in it. We're going to dive deeper into your word while we're in it, so that when we come out of it, Lord, we'll be able to look back over it and see why you did the desert the way that you did. God, you are an amazing God. You are a loving God. And so today we say thank you. God, we appreciate you for who you are. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. I want to encourage you that you be reminded.
This album is dedicated to everybody that's been there.
Yes.
I hope you've enjoyed this record.
Yes. Thank you, Lord. Yes. Yes.
I just got one more thing I want to do. If you're going for something,
here we go. Yes. Come on, Kirk. This is Kirk Franklin. Blessing in the storm. Yes. 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 Thank you, Sharon. Yes. Come on now.
this
yes. Right.
And listen, if you feel it sick in your mind and feel like giving up, listen.
Yes.
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 This is all you gotta do.
Say Jesus, please.
Hold on and call him.
Have a blessing in the storm.
Yes, thank you, Lord, for the blessing in this song.
Some of y'all have been in some bad relationships.
Come on, Jesus.
Some of you had your heart broken and you've been lied to. I want to let you know that there is
you all be blessed.
And he will supply your every need, family.
When I cannot see.
Be blessed, everyone.